I wanted to spend a few minutes and introduce some vocabulary around a few core challenges in managing identity in healthcare and beyond. I want to argue that today things are pretty broken, even when they seem to be working kind of okay, and then point forward to a set of emerging specifications that are the first thing I've seen in a long time that really look like they could actually make a dent in the problem. Think a little bit about a roadmap towards getting there. So to start off, I wanted to introduce a few pieces of vocabulary all around the issue of identity. And maybe the way I would state this to begin with is that today, every time we have a new relationship, it starts from a blank slate online. So this could be a relationship between a patient and a healthcare provider, or a patient who is a beneficiary of an insurance program, or it could even be an organizational relationship between a healthcare provider and the health system where they work. All kinds of these individual relationships. And every time we start one, it's a blank slate where people have to convey information about who they are and how they can sign in and make decisions about what kind of data they want to share. And so I want to introduce these three points of vocabulary to start. First off is identity. So these are really questions about who are you and what qualifications do you have? So are you a licensed physician? Are you a licensed driver? Are you a citizen or a resident of a given territory? And how do you present this information? What kind of documentation is required to get that across? Those are all issues about identity. Another related issue is authentication. This is really about how do you sign in to a website? What kind of account do you use? How do you make sure that other people can't sign into that website and get access to your account if you don't want them to? What kinds of protections, second factor, passwords, additional devices, all those kinds of things have to do with problem of authentication. And then there's a set of issues about sharing and privacy. So if you're giving me access to some of your data, what am I allowed to do with those data? Can I share them? With whom can I share them? Where are those data allowed to go? Do you want to be notified when those data do flow? Basically, what should I be doing to protect your privacy? How do we set up those expectations? And these three issues together, identity and authentication and sharing, represent a set of core infrastructure that today really doesn't work that well on the web. So I want to dig into each of these quickly, starting with identity. So today, I would argue things are kind of a mess when it comes to answering this question of who are you? And in the healthcare space, we basically have two ways that we do this. The first one is in-person identity proofing. So I'm going to come into the healthcare office and show my driver's license to front office staff, to a clerk behind the desk. The good thing about this is there's sort of a high trust environment there. You can build on top of these existing relationships. But the bad thing is that it's very slow and expensive to do this in person. And you have to do it again every time you have a new relationship with a different hospital or a different clinic or health system. You've got to drive across town and show them the right kind of documentation before you can get onboarded in that process. And especially if you've moved and you no longer are able to drive across town, that can become very difficult. The other major approach that we take to identity in healthcare is knowledge-based identity proofing. So these are often the kinds of online workflows where you're redirected to an identity proofing service, like the ones that are run by Experian, for example. You answer a bunch of detailed questions like, you know, what color is your Volkswagen and what county did you used to live in 17 years ago and all these kinds of things. And the nice thing about these workflows is that they are fast and they're automatic, so you don't have to drive across town. But there's a couple real downsides. One is that they're actually quite expensive for the relying parties. So every time you go through a flow like that, it costs dollars, you know, somewhere in the order of $1 to $5 to go through that flow. But the more insidious challenge here is really that this kind of identity proofing system relies on quote unquote proof that are really just guessable. And these are data that are subject to breach. And more reliance on these kinds of identity proofing systems based on knowledge means that there's an incentive for organizations that run these systems to pile up as much data about individual consumers, about individual people as they can, because the bigger and the more differentiated that pile becomes, the more valuable the identity proofing service becomes. So it offers this sort of incentivization for hoarding data. And we've seen over and over again that when these piles of data get created, they tend to leak over time. So that's a little bit about the mess that we're in with respect to identity. I want to say a couple things about authentication as well. So when you want to securely sign into a website today, still the most common way this happens is through pairwise accounts. every new website that I'm going to have a relationship with, each organization I'm going to talk to, I'm going to create a new username and a new password and, you know, do my best to navigate through everybody's different password requirements. Some people require a certain amount of punctuation. Some people prohibit certain punctuation marks, and you have to sort of figure out something that's going to meet everybody's requirements. And often what this means is people reuse passwords from site to site, or they use password resets very heavily. They just assume they're going to forget their password each time and have a link email to them when they want to log in again. And then password security really falls just back to email. Or people move over to password management tools, tools like LastPass that lets you keep a collection of passwords for all the different sites that you want to sign into. And then as long as you keep that secure, you're in a little bit better shape. And then on top of just usernames and passwords, we see more and more prevalent support for second factor or two-step authentication. And this actually provides a meaningful and important layer of additional security, but it also brings quite varied workflows to the table. So every provider that's going to let you sign in with two-factor, it's the provider who decides what kind of factors they're going to support. Lots of different individual applications here, some that have custom apps that run on your phone, some that go by secure text message or SMS rather, or email. And as a consumer, you basically have to deal with all of these different apps and approaches if you want to opt into a higher level of security, because you have to meet each service provider wherever they live. And then, of course, we have a prevalent support for single sign-on across the web. So if I want to sign into a website using a third-party account, like using my Facebook account or my Twitter or my Google account, and this can be very convenient because it's effectively one-click sign-in to a website using my existing account. And the security is actually quite good, too, because those organizations are good at managing account security. The real challenge here is that your identity, when you sign in with Google or when you sign in with Facebook, really doesn't belong to you. It's sort of rented to you or leased to you by Facebook or by Google. And at any point, if you lose access to your Facebook account or your Google account, you also lose access to any of those downstream websites that you sign into through those accounts. So it's not really up to you whether you keep that account over time. It's up to some third party. And also at the same time, the companies that lease your identity to you are charging a price, even if it's not dollars. They're charging a price in privacy and tracking, because every time you use that Facebook account to sign into a third-party website, Facebook learns one more thing about where you're signing in, what kind of services you're using, how often you're using them. They're part of that loop each time you sign in using your Facebook account. And so there's a real loss of privacy in that context with single sign-on. So that's a little bit about where we are today in security. And then finally, specifically for healthcare, I wanted to share a couple thoughts about how data sharing and privacy and transparency work. So the first thing to say here is that there are many kinds of data sharing that are allowed under HIPAA, including a very broad permission for a covered entity to share data for purposes of treatment or payment or healthcare operations. And this leads to a kind of an on by default sort of sharing in those contexts. Perfectly legal under HIPAA, but this is a kind of a data sharing that is totally opaque to consumers. And what we found more and more recently is that it's surprising to consumers, and it can be distasteful to consumers if their data are shared with organizations that they don't trust or organizations they feel like they have a reason to mistrust. And so more and more, we're bringing to light these kinds of data sharing pathways that work under HIPAA, but that don't necessarily work as society evolves, doesn't really meet our societal expectations. At the same time, under HIPAA, there is the expectation that when an individual's data is shared outside of the covered entity, there's what's called an accounting of disclosures. So that individual is supposed to have a right to learn about the fact that their data has been disclosed. That's a right that's provided under HIPAA, but it's really a right in theory only. Nobody's figured out how to do this properly in the real world, and the Office for Civil Rights really doesn't penalize healthcare organizations for failing to meet this benchmark simply because it's not practical. And at the same time, data can be de-identified, and then there's no accounting for disclosures required because the data have met a certain set of HIPAA safe harbor de-identification requirements, and at that point, they can be sold or shared pretty broadly. And of course, this is a bit of a fiction because just meeting those HIPAA safe harbor requirements doesn't mean that the data are really de-identified. They're not really anonymous. They can be re-identified downstream. So again, perfectly legal under HIPAA, but doesn't provide the kind of a privacy protection that we expect. And then, even though there's many ways in which data are allowed to flow and do flow under HIPAA, still healthcare data are not usually available when they're needed, the most. So this is a problem that the Office of the National Coordinator for Health IT has been trying to tackle for a long time, relying on a notion of national query networks so that one healthcare provider can sort of broadcast a query to neighboring providers or even providers all around the country to say, you know, I'm seeing a patient named Josh with such and such birth date. Do you have any records about this person? And we've been working through sort of the same set of protocols over and over again. We've seen the ONC make several attempts, most recently just in 2019 and 2020, through the Trusted Exchange Framework and Common Agreement, many attempts to have these kinds of query networks come up to speed and provide clinicians with a way to run these queries. But under the hood, it's all based on guesswork when it comes to identity matching. It's a set of probabilistic algorithms that have false positives and false negatives. So in the best case, a clinician might get back a set of hits that are mostly about the patient they have in front of them. And they need to be really skeptical. They need to read each record carefully and think to themselves, is this really about my patient, or is this just about someone with a similar name? And they need to view every record with that kind of discerning eye. But doing any better is pretty untenable in this system. Validating each individual identity link manually requires buy-in from across the ecosystem, and it's pretty expensive. And if you ask an individual patient to review those kinds of links, it introduces a lot of workflow challenges. At what point should they be doing that, and how do those results get shared? So even though we've got kind of widespread support for sharing these data, the shaky identity bedrock means that the sharing doesn't work so well clinic to clinic. So what I wanted to do then is describe a set of emerging standards that are the first thing I've seen in a long time that really look like they could move the needle on this set of problems about identity and authentication and really transparency around sharing decisions, the privacy aspect. So these are the decentralized identity specifications that are emerging today in the World Wide Web Consortium and in the Decentralized Identity Foundation. It's a core set of standards that allow an individual to obtain what's called a verifiable credential, which works a lot like a physical card that you might have in your wallet today. So in the physical world, when you get a driver's license, you might have to show up in person to a state DMV and fill out some forms. And then you get a physical card that you can carry with you for the next 5 years. And anytime you want to demonstrate who you are, you can take that card out of your wallet and hand it over the counter and show it to someone and prove who you are. And the nice thing about this is it's totally explicit. As a consumer, you know exactly when you're using that driver's license. You can decide when you're willing to show it and when you're not. And when you have that interaction and you hand it across the counter to a clerk, the state is not involved at that step. They don't learn. The state doesn't learn everywhere you go and everywhere you present that driver's license. They just know that they've issued a credential that's going to be valid for 5 years. And so this set of open standards for verifiable credentials gives you very similar properties in the electronic world. It gives individuals a kind of a electronic card that they can keep in a digital wallet and can present those credentials when and how they choose following a set of open standards. And the nice thing here is the credentials can be mixed and matched. So you might want to show proof that you have healthcare insurance as well as proof that you have a driver's license. And you can pick those two digital cards out of your virtual wallet and present them side by side. You can decide what information you want to share. And when you do it, that is a conversation between you and the healthcare organization that you're talking with. It doesn't require other actors from the outside world. The state doesn't need to be involved in those conversations. And your insurance company doesn't need to be involved in that conversation unless you want them to be. So that's a really powerful privacy-preserving set of specifications that gives consumers much more control over what aspects of their identity they want to share. And the nice thing here is that even if the individual initial identity proofing step happens in person and requires deep scrutiny, even if that's a pretty expensive step, those costs can be amortized over the next several years when you have that credential and you present it at all the different places that need to learn about you. So the idea is, let's do those expensive steps once and then reuse those identity cards, reuse those virtual credentials as often as they're needed. So there's a rich set of specifications for verifiable credentials. And then this same technology allows individuals to do authentication or sign in using a set of specs from the OpenID Foundation and again from the Decentralized Identity Foundation, so that just like you can pull out a digital card from your wallet, you can digitally sign in to a website using a credential that's created just for signing into that one website. And those can be stored securely on a mobile device. They can be protected using biometrics, so something like a fingerprint or a face ID or just a PIN. And the nice thing about this is there's no built-in tracking by the identity providers. You can sign into any website that you want to, and that's just a conversation between you and the website that you're signing into. There's no third party involved at the time that you're doing the sign-in. So this is a really powerful set of foundational standards that help individuals demonstrate aspects of their identity and also to sign in or authenticate to a variety of different kinds of websites or applications across this ecosystem. It's a very powerful set of technologies. And then at a slightly earlier stage of the standards process are some really interesting aspects. So we talked about accounting for disclosures. We said this is really impractical to do in today's paper world. But using a set of these decentralized identity standards, we have an emerging concept called consent receipts. The idea here is that if I give a website permission to use my data for some purpose, then the website gives back to me a consent receipt. And this is a digitally signed document that says, you've shared with us the following information. Here's what you've allowed us to do with it. Here are the purposes of use that are permitted. All those kinds of details that are written down on that receipt and given back to me. And then I can keep a folder full of those digital receipts. And at any point, I can look through them and answer the question, where are my data going today? Who's allowed to use them? And if I see something I don't like, I can follow up on it. I can go back to the site or to the service and revoke access in the future. So that's consent receipts is one really important emerging idea. And the other one is this notion of a personal data hub. So that anytime I have a relationship with an outside business and they need to send me a bit of information, maybe a consent receipt, for example, maybe that happens over an email system, but maybe it happens through a more secure digital transmission into a hub. And I say, you know, anytime you've got something to let me know, here's a key that you can use to securely send it into my personal data hub. So consent receipts and data hubs are a couple of examples of specifications in this space of decentralized identity that are early but very promising. And together, this set of technologies really starts to get at a few of those core challenges. So I wanted to share a view on how we can make some progress in a practical way towards these challenges in a few different horizons. So horizon one is really just deploying sort of off-the-shelf tools in healthcare that are available from service providers today. Things like Azure Active Directory, Fire servers, and API gateways that just implement the best practices such as they exist here in 2020. But thinking ahead, especially in the healthcare standards accelerator world, we've got a number of projects that simply leave identity out of scope. They truly rely on identity under the hood, but aren't trying to tackle identity. And so there's a really nice opportunity to develop these specifications in tandem. I'll give you a couple quick examples. One is appointment scheduling guide. This is part of one of the Argonaut projects to say, if a consumer wants to schedule an appointment with a new healthcare provider, maybe search across healthcare providers for available appointment slots, and that consumer finds a slot but doesn't yet have any relationship with this healthcare provider, well, it's a blank slate. They have to start by signing into that provider's website, creating a new account, uploading insurance documents, all of that. This set of distributed or decentralized identity technologies gives consumers now a way to present an ID that they've already got, maybe from a healthcare institution across the street, or maybe from their insurance company, and present that information in a standardized digital workflow so that we're not starting from a blank slate each time we want to create this relationship. Or similarly, for these data query networks under TEFCA, so through specifications and groups like Commonwell and Care Quality, consumers are supposed to have access. They're by law, by regulation, the expectation is that consumers can query for their own data inside of these networks. And today, the networks basically don't solve this problem. They hope that it can be outsourced to a third party, some kind of trusted third party who would be able to identity proof individuals. But even in that world, what you get are these probabilistic links that healthcare organizations are going to be very hesitant to rely on. So they'll say effectively, oh, I see that you've signed in as Josh, and I'm only 85% sure that this record belongs to you, but my threshold is 99.9%. And so instead of giving you a list of your records, I'm going to give you a list of zero records and say, we just couldn't be sure enough. That's effectively the kind of consumer access that we're heading towards today in that space. And there's an opportunity to really flip this on its head by putting consumers in control of maintaining these identities across the healthcare ecosystem. And once you've got your identity with a variety of different healthcare organizations, now you've got a way to construct a 360-degree view of who you are. So thinking beyond some of these near-term standards acceleration projects, there's an opportunity to build out specifications that deal with information flows that we're really just starting to recognize the need for today in healthcare. But permissions that go deeper than and can sit behind or serve as a backstop to HIPAA is one really important aspect. So how does an individual consumer generate privacy expectations, get something like a consent receipt and something like an accounting for disclosures when those data are shared? It gives a transparent view about what information is being shared and then gives consumers a way to come back and change those knobs and dials, change the permissions they've granted after the fact. So that's a really quick view of how I see some of these specifications, both well-developed and emerging, playing out over time. And I think this is an area where the right kind of investment across the healthcare ecosystem can really lay important foundation for making a difference in the way that consumers, as well as healthcare providers, interact with this ecosystem.